bulk aluminum microfabrication. Okay, technique number one. So I have actually designed and microfabricated several types of silicon microfuel cells using Deep RIE, and had several articles published. Three of these articles comprise my thesis, and in all of these articles I have used black silicon in one goal or the other. Black silicon is a nanoscale pattern of needle-like structures. You will see that in the next pictures. Okay, so the first article here uses black silicon as a gas diffusion layer. I'm not going to talk about fuel cells very much in detail because I did that last year, and all of you, of course, remember, and I don't have the time here. So, these fuel cells are very simple in this article because the black silicon acts as a gas diffusion layer, and it's made from the same silicon piece from which all the rest is made. So basically these chips are monolithical. Also, as you can see, the fabrication process or process flow is extremely simple. This is because I'm lazy, and this laziness has helped me a lot during my PhD thesis. We have three kinds of flow field. I have made experiments with all three worked more or less well. In this paper, we have also characterized the black silicon with scanning electron microscopy and atomic force microscopy. And we didn't break, that time we didn't break any AFM tips, which is, I don't know how we managed. Then, a year later we tried and we broke all 12. Anyhow, so, the next article is based on the same process flow. So it leverages the simplicity of these fuel cells, but here I'm using a little topological trick, which I cannot explain in words as well as the picture does. But in any case, with this topological trick, stacking of microfuel cells becomes more or less simple. With microfuel cells, the stacking is very challenging, but with this trick, it is simplified. These polarization curves here, they show that this stack actually works as a stack because the open circuit voltage is about double that of one cell. So that validates the stack. Third article. Here the black silicon has a completely different role. It's not anymore a gas diffusion layer, but it actually interfaces the conductive silicon with the commercial gas diffusion layer. And this is the principle. As you can see, the black silicon, which here is greenish, just to mess with you, is actually penetrating in the gas diffusion layer, and thus it increases the conductivity. In the article, we actually prove separately that the conductivity of this interface increases with black silicon. And then we separately actually characterize the microfuel cells, and then we show that the microfuel cells with black silicon have better performance. The SEM pictures in this flow are of a commercial gas diffusion layer. They have a micro and a macro porous layer, and this interface between the black silicon and the gas diffusion layer behaves very differently based on whether the micro or the macro porous layer is turned towards it. Technique number two, picosecond laser ablation of silicon. Now, I believe that laser ablation has a very bright future in microfabrication, and especially femtosecond laser ablation. I do believe that that's going to have a huge role as soon as a femtosecond laser systems become a little bit cheaper. I hope this article, which is very, 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 very long, so long that we had to put a lot of tables and scans and pictures in a, what is it called, additional materials, and even so, the main article was 9 pages, but that is because we did so many experiments. Here I will talk about one aspect. We have tried two different ablation modes. Low energy and high energy ablation modes. Top row is low energy ablation mode. And as you can see, the microchannels are smooth, relatively smooth, nice looking, little redeposition on the sides, and the geometrical aspect is well controlled. It's everything else is it's actually the opposite with the high energy ablation channels. But high energy ablation allows for faster machining because more material is removed per pulse, so you need fewer pulses, so the process is faster. Surprisingly to me, after reading all the literature, high energy ablation actually induces fewer stresses than the low energy ablation. In the article, we explain why that could be the case. These are, of course, Raman maps, as you probably recognize. These are just some of the many experiments in that article. Okay, technique number three. Wet etching for bulk aluminum microfabrication. I'm very proud of this because I actually developed this technique, and it's a very economical technique. As you can see, the device used is just a hot plate and a beaker, and of course a very cheap version, but sophisticated tool still. Okay, so this article, because it's a pioneering article about this kind of micromachining, is focusing a lot on the microfabrication part, on the measurement of roughness, edge rate, the different angles that you obtain, and so on. I will not go into detail, I will just show you this beautiful SCM picture of the rough surface, and I will tell you that we found that the roughness increases with the edge time. So the longer you edge, the rougher the surface becomes. And we believe that this is because we actually don't use pure aluminum, but we use aluminum alloy 6061, which contains silicon, iron, and some other alloying elements which are not etched by the solution. And so they deposit and create this roughness. There are other indications that are mentioned in the article of why this is the case. As you can see, the process flow is even simpler, right? It became even lazier during the etch. My PhD. But laziness pays off. These microfuel cells are record breakers in the special category of microfuel cells. So even though we checked the literature several times, we could not find microfuel cells with better performance than these. And they have not only great transient performance, which you can see with these polarization curves and more than 1.1 amperes per square centimeter. But even the sustained performance, which we obtained by doing chrono-amperometric measurements over 12 hours, even that is really great. And actually, if you check the literature on microfuel cells, you will see that very few authors do chrono-amperometric measurement. I don't know why, and maybe they are just, you know, hiding the dirty laundry. I have no idea, but it's very exceptional to see chrono-amperometric measurements in microfuel cells. So, this was the last article that makes part of my thesis, and I thought of just mentioning some other Philippe theory that I do. Okay, so as I said, I'm a main user of several tools. This is a KOH etching setup. The new Vecta profilometer, very expensive, and we bought it second hand. And it's still expensive. And then the laser writer, which is a tool that I by now know as my pockets. I don't know what I have in my pockets, but I know that tool better. And finally, I'm the main user of the Thin Film Lab, in which I have had a lot of work recently. Among the other work that I had there is the creation of this lithography corner. So you have yellow light here, and you can do lithography. There is a spinner and a hot plate and a UV lamp, so people can do some simple microfabrication outside of the clean room. And I will be one of them because I'm lazy, so I don't have to put on the mask and everything. I can do some of my fabrication this way. Laziness, remember, always helps. Okay, so there are some articles that I have done that are not part of my thesis at all, like this one about patterning on Mukom, the material that Özkan has mentioned previously. So we have patterned it to the laser writer that we have seen on the previous slide. And the nice thing that we obtained quite sharp corners and relatively high aspect ratio structures. And right now there is a little bit of a battle. We will see who gets better results, Özkan or us. So we'll see. But we are not stabbing anybody in the back, officially. Okay, so some other articles that I have collaborated. In this one, I actually developed the process flow for the microfabrication of these seemingly simple microreactors. And this article that was recently accepted for publication actually uses those microfuel cells that I presented at the beginning. So the very first microfuel cells, the super simple ones, here they are used as an analytical platform for comparing the performance of different catalyst support layers. So the idea here is that if you use microfuel cells, then the amount of analyte that you need is very small. So, and that idea I would like to expand with another article where I will hopefully be the main author. And so, what happens next? I will hopefully get my PhD in March or April, if everything goes smoothly. And after that, I know that I cannot continue now to university, so I have to do something. But I would like to actually continue, at least physically, to sit in the same place, because it's very messy and it would take me too much time to put things in order. Anyway, I don't know, how is the time? Am I over the time?
Do you have many things?
No, sir, I'm done. That's okay. Yeah.
A little bit behind the schedule, but